So how about we, you want to get started to just play a few things?
Sure, I could do that.
All right. Well, maybe I'll just do a quick intro. Everybody, welcome to all the folks joining us on this Sunday afternoon, wherever you are. We have Nashville, Vancouver, New Mexico. If you're far away, shout out in the, say something in the chat so we see where you're coming from. Tristan has been on the bluegrass scene now for many, many years, and I first met him when he was just a whippersnapper in his dad's band, jamming around the campfire at Nibble Fingers, probably about 7 or 8 years ago. And impressive then, and he's gone on to do great things with Scroggins and Colorado and Greg Blake and Alyssa Rose and lots of other people. So great to have you with us, Tristan. And yeah, looking forward to seeing what you got to share with us today.
Well, thank you, Eric, and thanks for asking me to do this. It's fun to get to perform. It's very different performing versus practicing. When you perform, you can't just stop, and it's there's not really a way to like recreate that headspace while you're practicing. So it's nice to get any chance that I can find to rework that muscle. Yeah, I'll play some stuff. It's kind of funny, you know. I'm ostensibly just a side person. I don't really sing. I sing for fun. And, you know, I'm just in other people's bands, and I'm a composer, but like, not really for solo mandolin stuff. So putting together little shows has been kind of interesting. And when I would I started teaching a lot more camps after I left my dad's band like 2 years ago or something, and I started teaching at more camps just by myself, and I was in staff concerts and there was nobody there that I knew, so I started putting together little medleys of tunes, and so I'm going to try to play some of those, see how that goes. I'll also happily take requests if anybody wants to hear anything in particular, but I think I'll start out with this kind of simple one. Yeah. I was on a very long and boring tour in Germany a couple years ago. Had a lot of free time on my hands, so I worked a lot on cross-picking mandolin and developed this sort of melodic cross-picking style. So I'll do a Cumberland Gap in that style, and then try to go into a great request there, Old Dangerfield. I'll try to go into a tune that I wrote and perform with Alyssa Rose in our duet called Scroggins and Rose. The tune's called Eagle's Nest. Thank you. What could be beeping? Excuse me. Who is beeping? Oh my gosh.
Sounds like my alarm clock.
What? Somebody is not muted.
Oh, okay. It was my alarm clock, my analog alarm clock. Don't know why. The button wasn't pushed. Anyway. Oh, here, I'll move it back so you can see me a little bit better. And I'll go back into that second song. Apologies. I can see all of the hands. I like this motion. That helps. Thank you. Well, let's see. I'll do another little medley here. Oh, we'll do a Canadian medley. That sounds fun. When I was teaching at, what is that camp? The Northern Lights, which is in Saskatchewan, up in near Big River. I met Calvin Volrath and some other folks, and I learned about Métis music, which was a lot. It was just very, very cool and fun. And after essentially 10 years of practicing every single day, I can do the foot thing, where they play tunes and do the rhythm with their feet. I can barely do it. I can't do it tonight because I haven't figured out how to have my camera and the mic work so you can actually see or hear any of that. But I'll play a few of the tunes. I'll play a couple of John Arcand tunes, one called Kendra McGilligray's Hornpipe, and then Gray Owl, very popular John Arcand tune, and then The Old Reel of Eight, which is just an old Métis tune that I learned from Bruce Molsky. See if I can remember them. How does that one go? Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Yay. Woo. I saw a question. Let's see if I can read, comprehend, and answer it quickly. Do you always hold your pick like that? Yeah, a little bit. When I first started playing the mandolin, there was a guy that, it wasn't Bob, different random guy, was really insistent that I hold it with three fingers. Just was really insistent about that. So I did for a long time, and then I kind of, over time, developed this sort of, weird three-point system where it's kind of like that. But yeah, I kind of often will have my index finger sort of almost curled around it. Only recently have I gotten to where I can actually hold it the way that a lot of people do, with kind of like a loose fist with it sticking out just like that. But realistically, it moves around, my pick moves around a lot in my hand while I'm playing, because I like to take advantage of being able to get a lot of different sounds. There's a lot of different things, sounds that you can get based on how you're holding your pick, how tight or how loose. I like to try to take advantage of those. So I kind of move it around. How long does it take? This is a tortoiseshell pick. I don't really like blue chip picks. I just don't really like how they sound. That's just personal. People stopped using tortoiseshell a lot because kind of hard to get. It is illegal, technically. Also vaguely unethical, depending on where you're getting it from, and they wear down. So it's actually really easy for me to get tortoiseshell picks because nobody likes them. So that's how I get mine, is people just give them to me because they know I like them. But yeah, it's thin compared to, I have a blue chip somewhere. I think it's one of the ones that Chris Thiele uses, and it's thinner than that. But I mean, it's, you know, you couldn't bend it or anything. It's still thick. Anyway, I'll do another tune and then answer another question. Let's do a little bit of both here. Oh, let's see if I can do this set. No, I'll play it safe. I'll do this Bill Monroe medley. I know all those tunes pretty well. All right, I'm going to do four Bill Monroe tunes, kind of random ones. We'll start with The Chilly Winds of Shannon, which he never recorded on one of his own records. Bill wrote tons of tunes, especially towards the end of his life. He was, you know, writing at least a tune a day for years. And I could talk about all that for a long time, but I'll play some music. So this, the only recording of him playing this is on, I think it's on a Jimmy Campbell recording. Jimmy Campbell, great fiddle player. And Bill recorded mandolin on a record that has The Chilly Winds of Shannon. Then I'll go into Northern White Clouds. I actually also learned that version from Jimmy Campbell. Has a really weird history, this tune, but really fun, kind of weird, very different sounding Monroe tune, Northern White Clouds. Then the Brown County Breakdown, pretty popular depending on what part of the country you're in. Named for Brown County, Indiana, where Bean Blossom is. And then Jekyll Island, which is a kind of random tune from the 80s of Bill's that's named after a festival in Jekyll Island, South Carolina. South Carolina? No, Georgia. Jekyll Island is in Georgia. Okay, let's see if I can do it. Sorry, it sounds better if it's in tune. Let's see here. Okay. Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. You know, question, how long does it take to arrange tunes like this? Days, weeks, months? Well, you know, it's like anything else. It's a skill, so the more you do it, the easier it gets. The first thing that I did, the complicated cross-picking thing, I mean, that was... It took, you know, I guess a month, but like doing it, like I was, again, on a very boring tour. So I was spending like at least 3 hours a day, if not like five or six, just only practicing doing like that cross picking stuff. And figuring out stuff. And plus I had some other people around, who I could kind of bounce ideas off. And then the stuff with Alyssa, I mean, the stuff that Alyssa and I work on together, the original music, I mean, that's months of like very painstaking, like writing and arranging and figuring out what works and like playing it for people and concerts and sort of gauging how it went. And that's very meticulous, but just because we kind of choose to be meticulous about it. Preferred mic for mandolin. Again, I don't know anything about audio stuff. I have this great Ear Trumpet Labs mic. I don't remember all of a sudden which one it is. It's Delfina, I think, is the one. So it's a Myrtle diaphragm inside the Edwina casing. So it looks like an Edwina, but it has a wider diaphragm than the usual Edwina. And Jeff Scroggins in Colorado used one of these for years while we were on tour. So I'm just used to it. But it's also the only mic that I own. So... Well, I like 57. Is that the one that's straight? I don't know. I don't know anything about mics. Will you do any online camps during COVID? I did do a ToonFox. ToonFox, I was supposed to teach at their in-person camp. ToonFox is like a website that does a lot of online learning stuff, and they were having an in-person camp. Obviously got canceled due to COVID, but they transitioned online, and that was a lot of fun. That was like a full weekend camp. I haven't done any other like full online camps. I don't have any coming up, I don't think. I mean, I have my weekly workshop. It's not like a camp, but you know, some online teaching with a bunch of people, so that's fun. All right, let's do another tune. Let's see what we got here. Well, maybe I'll try the Texas one now. So, I was actually born in Texas, but I never like really lived there, so it's not a big part of my identity or anything. But I did grow up playing in a lot of contests, sort of coincidentally. I mean, it was like we, again, didn't have like a ton of money growing up, and so there were multiple points in my life where... my dad would travel to banjo contests to win the money or the banjo and sell it or whatever, because we needed some money. And I would come along and enter the mandolin contests. And a lot of those contests were attached to like traditional like Texas old time fiddling contests, which is this whole big tradition. And I only know a little bit about it just from being around other fiddle players and stuff, but I think most significantly being around Megan Lynch here in Nashville. Megan's a big influence in my life in a lot of ways, and she's I don't understand how the titles work. She's won something, one of them, seven times. There's so many different categories and stuff. But, you know, she grew up in that whole world. It's taught me a lot about that. And so I've been learning a lot of those tunes. And so I'm going to try to play four of them here in a row. We'll see how seamlessly I can go in between them. It depends a lot on if I can remember the first note of the next tune quickly. But we'll start with the Red Fox Waltz. Beautiful waltz. I'm not going to do it in a very traditional way, but that's okay. And then Snowshoes, which is a fun little tune. And then an old tune called Tugboat, My version's based on Benny Thomason's version, and then the Fort Worth Rag. So we sort of get the waltz or tune of choice. Snowshoes might be a breakdown even, and Fort Worth Rag, because you got to play. Depending on there's so many different rules and things, but let's see if I can do it. Well, you know, not without some flavor there, but all right, let's see here. I'll try something. I'll do something a little bit easier. I'll just play a tune and not try to think of four different tunes at the same time. Let's see. I'll try the Seneca Square Dance. I like the Seneca Square Dance. Pretty simple tune. Not that much fun to play on the fiddle, but on the mandolin and guitar, you can add lots of fun other chords and stuff. Okay, let's see. Get comfortable here. Oh, and I'll tune a little bit. I'll try to answer something while I tune. Great flavor. That's what I'm going for. Talk, so I'm not just tuning. I haven't been doing that much in quarantine. I live alone. Well, I live in like a house. I live like in a basement apartment. So I don't really see a lot of people, but at least here in Nashville, it doesn't get too cold. And there's lots of different folks, so on days that it's warm enough, you know, I'll go sit in somebody's backyard and play some tunes and stuff. I've just been learning a lot of tunes. It's kind of boring to play bluegrass music alone. It doesn't really work. So, playing a lot of old-time tunes and just kind of learning different stuff just for fun. You know, I post a lot of videos on my Instagram and Facebook and, what's the other one? YouTube? Oh, gosh. Let's see. Oh, I got a little... Is this the direction? No. Yes? Yes, but I have to do this. Gosh. Oh. There's all the things. Hello. Yes, you can see me in all these places. Okay. Now for a tune. I think I'm going to try to do... That's right, I said the Seneca Square Dance. I'll do that. Oh, I don't... Okay. I'll make that go away. That's really annoying looking. None. All right, great. All right. added in, I wasn't feeling super stoked on Seneca Square Dance, so I added in Lost Girl there at the end, which was kind of the first old-time tune I really learned. Such a fun, such a beautiful tune and such a fun one. It really has, it epitomizes the sort of old-time revival sound of playing playing a melody based around the one, so in this case the G, but playing a four chord over it. Very old-time revival, and very beautiful. It's actually super common in bluegrass stuff too, just it shows up in a different way with the singing. Let's see, I'll play something else. Well, we'll see. I got a little Celtic medley written down here. Very much not my strong suit, which is a great way to introduce a set of music, is by saying you don't really know how to play it. But these are some tunes. I don't know a lot of Celtic music, but these are a few tunes that I've learned. Start out with Turning Tide, which is a modern, a lot of these are modern actually. Turning Tide was written by a fiddler from London whose name I've suddenly forgotten. I learned this from a harp player that I know named Alana Thornburg. Alana's an incredible harp player, and she plays a lot of bluegrass and old time on the harp. She's extremely cool. We've done a couple of videos together. I would extremely recommend checking her out. She's amazing. Then The Bus Stop, which is an American tune, I think from Portland, but it's a fun little reel. And then Frank's Reel, which is written by John McCuster, who's from Scotland. And then I'll try to do the Milky Way Reel, which is old, I assume, and then I think it's called Glass of Beer. We'll see if I remember any or all of those. Thank you. Something like that, you know. Well, okay. I'll do one more little medley, and then maybe we can play a tune together. You know, muted and whatnot, but we'll do something together. I'll do one more little medley. This next one's very fun. Very random. Start with the Tennessee Waltz, written by Pee Wee King in response to the Kentucky Waltz. There is a beautiful park here in Nashville, outside of the Capitol. It's just a cool park, lots of historical stuff. And there's this space that has like little plaques for lots of different musicians, mostly who are from Tennessee, but some people who weren't from Tennessee but had a very significant impact on the music of Tennessee. And there's a lot of very cool people from lots of different genres of music, including lots of bluegrass folks. And the bell, there's these like bell towers there, and not on the hour, I don't know when, seemingly randomly, they'll play various of Tennessee state songs, and one of them is the Tennessee Waltz, which is always very nice, and also a little bit hilarious because they're bells, so trying to play a song, a diatonic, like a song that's in like a major scale is very funny because the notes ring over each other and there's lots of dissonance, but it's a nice idea anyway. So start with the Tennessee Waltz and then do Wiley Laws's tune, which is just an old-time tune, and then Wichita Lineman, which is a Jimmy Webb song that Glenn Campbell had a big hit with. So let's try these. Thank you. Hey, yeah. Let's play a tune together. Why don't we do something a little bit sort of simple? I will say, if you... well, I'd say first, thanks to Eric, and thanks to the association, which, the full name of which, I should have written down. I know that Bluegrass and Old Time are a part of the name, and the Pacific, I don't know what order those they all come in, but...
You got it.
Oh, great. I dearly miss visiting the Vancouver area. A lot of very favorite memories in the Anza Club, and we're at, well, my dad's up there now too. I don't know if y'all know, but my dad's living in Maple Ridge. Probably haven't seen him out and about. He just kind of hangs out inside. But anyway, if you enjoyed this, you can find me in the internet places. These internet places, to be specific, I have a lot of some music here. Oh gosh, it's double backwards. Okay, this is where all my music stuff is. You can buy CDs on the Bandcamp. Scroggins and Roses is a new CD we're really proud of. If you want to take lessons, my group lessons are through Nashville Acoustic Camps, and that's every week. And I sell, it's not really, it's complicated, but you can get a lot of transcriptions to a lot of the stuff that I played tonight on my Patreon page. Or if you just want to support me in general, the Patreon is really great. It's just like a subscription service, essentially, like, you know, paying for Netflix or something. And you get access to exclusive stuff like transcriptions and lesson videos and things. But, you know, a lot of people, I think, just, you know, like the videos that I make and stuff. And so it's just like $5 a month. And it's extremely helpful, actually, because, you know, it's just a lot of people giving me $5 a month. And it makes it so that I don't have to worry about whether or not I can pay my bills in this ongoing nightmare that we are enduring. And then if you want to see the various things that I'm doing, social media is the best way. I post pretty much everything up there. If you're wanting to, like, learn tunes, by the way, my YouTube page, there's lots of just videos of just me playing a tune. Lots of old-time tunes, lots of Texas tunes. Trying to get more bluegrass tunes in there. But, again, it's just me here, so. but, yeah, let's play a tune together. I want to do this. Why don't we just do one of my favorites? We could do the Cherokee Shuffle. I love the Cherokee Shuffle. Written by Tommy Jackson, who is a great Nashville fiddle player. Tommy was in a band called what was that band called? The Cherokee Fiddlers, I think. So I think that's where the name came from. The history of the tune's weird, because it is just, it's essentially Lost Indian, but it's like specifically, because there's the old-time version of Lost Indian that sounds a lot different, but there's like a kind of California-specific version of Lost Indian that Cherokee Shuffle is loosely based on. Anyway. I will just play it, and I'll play some rhythm, play it again. You guys do whatever you would like. Thank you. Yay! Oh, Bob, I can see you there. It's so good to see you, Bob. I hope you're doing good. And it's so good to see everybody. It's nice to see people and to remember that people exist.
Yes, thank you so much. Let's have everybody just turn their mute button off a second and do a big cheer. Normal.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We exist.
Real people exist. Yeah, Tristan, thanks so much. It was just great, great. Love the cross section of different kinds of tunes, the variety, and love to just to see your artistry there. I just want to make a quick announcement to everybody before you sign off. Tomorrow night we have our regular member-led jam, and we're trying a different thing. Tomorrow we're going to use the breakout room. We're going to have four breakout rooms, so we're going to have slower, faster, old time, and then an anything goes room. So I think it can be kind of cool, you know, fewer people mean you can lead more songs, kind of like smaller jam, and we're going to have people helping out, sort of facilitating, so that if you never led a song, then maybe this could be your chance with a smaller audience. So come join it. When you log on, you'll have to pick a room. So I'm not sure how this is all going to work. So it'll be an experiment. But anyway, so Tristan, thanks again. And please consider supporting him in one of those many ways that you've got set up, Tristan. That's awesome. And looking forward to, yeah, seeing you live and online and in all the other ways that you have going on.
Yeah. Thanks again, Eric. And I look forward to when, when things are different. But for now, I really love all the stuff that you guys are doing in the organization. So, it's really great to have organizations, and local bluegrass organizations are very important. And I'm very thankful that you guys are around.
All right. Well, take care, and thanks everybody for joining, and we'll catch you the next time.